Welcome back, I'm That Chemist, and this is another video in the Introductory Organic Chemistry lecture series. I haven't done these for quite a while, but I promised Maurice I would make one for Christmas, so that's what I'm doing now. I'm not planning on making more of these videos for quite some time, but I promised Maurice I would make this video by Christmas because I started it just about 6 months ago. So without further ado, let's get started. So the Diels-Alder reaction is a type of reaction known as a paracyclic reaction. It involves a 4 plus 2 cycloaddition between a diene and an alkene, or some other sort of dienophile. There are two typical types of Diels-Alder reactions. The first type is the normal demand Diels-Alder, which involves an electron-rich diene as well as an electron-poor alkene or other sort of dienophile. One example is shown here, where we have this electron-donating group on this diene, and we have an electron-deficient alkene. This reaction occurs, favoring this as the major product. Now, in addition to the normal demand Diels-Alder, you can also change up the electronics a little bit. So you can have an inverse demand Diels-Alder, which involves an electron-poor diene and an electron-rich alkene or dienophile. So here's what this would look like. Here you have an electron-withdrawing group instead of a donating group, and then the alkene or dienophile has an electron-donating group instead of an electron-withdrawing group. Overall, you get similar-looking product, but whether an electron-donating group or withdrawing group is present on the diene or dienophile can change. Now, if you were to have like a donating group on both of them, usually the reaction wouldn't work as well. So you can still have Diels-Alder reactions happening without a strong electron donating or withdrawing group, but having these groups tends to accelerate the rates, which is often desirable in chemistry. Because if the rates are low, chemistry doesn't really happen, at least not at a rate that we care about. So a little bit of commentary about this. The Diels-Alder reaction can sometimes involve other dienophiles, in addition to the typical alkene that you might have as your dienophile. So one example is an imine. This might have a strong electron withdrawing group like a sulfonyl group or a carbonyl. This just makes this more electrophilic and it makes the reaction go faster. So here you can see instead of getting a cyclohexene as we would get in the case of a typical Diels-Alder, instead we would have this tetrahydropyridine species. Now if we were to instead use an aldehyde or ketone instead of an alkene, we would get this dihydropyran as our product. Now, obviously, these are just a couple examples. There's other examples you could use, such as isocyanates, isothiocyanates, thiocarbonyl compounds, etc. The main reason that we want to specify a dienophile when we're talking about the Diels-Alder reaction is because if we call it just an alkene, it gets confusing because the diene has an alkene, so it's not very specific. So to be inclusive and to articulate specifically what we mean, we're referring to them as dienophiles because they love dienes. Now, regioselectivity. For your typical Diels-Alder reactions following normal electron demand, the reaction will follow what's known as the ortho-para rule. So dienes with a terminal substituent favor ortho products. This is pseudo-ortho. It's kind of like if we think about substituents on an aromatic ring, although you will get some small amounts of the meta product forming, where the electron withdrawing group would be meta to the donating group. And if you have a diene with an internal substituent, it will favor para products, although you will get some meta forming. And so this is what this would look like if you have an electron donating group in the 2 position. You'll end up getting pseudo-para type products. These are obviously not the only products that could form, and this is only the major products I'm talking about. And you can see that I haven't indicated the stereochemistry of these two substituents, and that's because we can form both exo and endo products. So the mechanism of the Diels-Alder reaction is pericyclic. Normally, the dienophile will react with an alkene from above or below, and this electron withdrawing group here could be pointed away or could be pointed towards the diene. Now, because this is a typical pericyclic reaction, the diene has to add from one face. You can't have half of it adding from above, half of it adding from below. So if something's external on the top and bottom, it's going to be pointed up in both cases, or it's going to be pointed down in both cases. You can't have a substituent that's on the outside in the top and bottom of the alkene ending up with different geometry in the product. So you have good regio control in that sense. Now, molecular orbital theory. We haven't talked about MO theory too much on the channel. I just decided to include a little bit here because this is a good introduction into why you should care about molecular orbital theory if you're studying organic chemistry. So this shows the energy levels of various electrons involved with the diene as well as the dienophile. So if we have an electron donating group on a diene, these electrons are relatively low in energy and they can donate their electrons into a dienophile's lowest unoccupied molecular orbital, also known as a LUMO. So because there's good orbital overlap, That means that it's possible to donate electron density from the HOMO of the diene into the LUMO of the dienophile. Now, in the opposite case, where we have inverse demand, where we have an electron withdrawing group on our diene and an electron donating group on our dienophile, the HOMO is higher in energy, and this has better orbital overlap with the LUMO of the diene. And so, instead, electron density can be donated initially from the dienophile to the LUMO of the diene. And so this is what this looks like. If you're wondering why the orbitals look different than they normally would in their ground state, that's because they're not in their ground state. This is an empty orbital where the electrons are being donated into. And you can see the orbital overlap here where the phase of these orbitals overlaps, which makes sense. Here you can see that this black part of this orbital overlaps with the black part of the LUMO orbital, and the same is true for the other portion of the diene. So this doesn't tell you too much about molecular orbital theory overall, but I thought it would be important to include this here as it's often taught as a portion of Diels-Alder chemistry. So endo versus exo products. When you do a Diels-Alder reaction, you can afford different diastereomers. You can also form different enantiomers, but that can't really be avoided unless you're using some sort of chiral system. So here we have an endo and an exo product. So what could happen is this dienophile could have the electron withdrawing group pointed away from the diene as it's approaching. Now, whether it approaches from above or below is random because there's no control over chirality here, right? It's just going to be a 50-50 mixture of enantiomers. It's going to be racemic. Here, because the electron withdrawing group is pointed out, we get the exo product, and these are opposite. So you can see the color here indicates that the electron withdrawing group and the electron donating group are on different sides of the cyclohexene ring. Now, if instead the dienophile approaches with the electron withdrawing group pointed towards the diene, you'll end up having the two substituents on the same side, and this is endo. You can think of endo like they're on the same endo, on the same end of the cyclohexane ring. They're pointed the same way. Now, if you're doing these sorts of reactions, oftentimes you can change selectivity between exo and endo by using a Lewis acid, and it can also enhance the rates. Although, depending on how sensitive your diene or your dienophile is, you might have some functional groups that wouldn't tolerate super harsh conditions. You might not want to use a Lewis acid. So, a couple examples of normal demand Diels-Alder reactions. Here, the electron donating group on our diene is just a methyl group. We actually have two methyl groups. And then on our dienophile, we have an alkyne, which is electron deficient from this phosphonate, as well as this trifluoromethyl group. So here you can see 110 degrees Celsius, 30 minutes, high conversion to the corresponding cyclohexadiene. You might be wondering, hey, wait a second, why does this have an extra double bond in it? And that's because we used an alkyne instead of an alkene. So you don't just have to use double bonds, you can also use triple bonds. In this next example, we have this isoindole, which reacts with this maliimide. And this is a reaction that occurs really easily because this is a really electron-deficient dienophile, and our diene is electron-rich. The nitrogen is electron-donating group, and so that makes this diene more reactive. There's actually two different dienes here which could potentially react. Technically, the benzene ring could act as a diene, and there are instances where you see that, such as in the case of anthracene. Another example of a Diels-Alder reaction is this conjugated diene reacting with this substituted maliimide. Again, this is a room temperature reaction. It happens very easily in dichloromethane in only 24 hours. Another example, which I thought was kind of cool, is this diene here with this four-membered ring lactam. And in this case, indium chloride was used as a Lewis acid to promote the reaction. This tetracyanoethylene is a really electron-deficient olefin, so it reacts extremely well. Now, if we're talking about inverse demand Diels-Alders, this is where we have an electron-donating group on the dienophile and an electron-withdrawing group on the diene. So here we have a vinyl ether. Vinyl ethers are really common electron-rich alkenes that can be used in Diels-Alder reactions. And the electron withdrawing groups that we have here include this carbonyl, this other carbonyl, although there is a very slight electron donating effect from this NH here. So this was done under high pressure. Even though this took over 10 days, they do still get some of their product. In this next example, the electron-rich alkene is this dihydrofuran. And the electron-deficient diene is this cyclohexadienone, which they generated in situ. This was done in methanol, 50 degrees for 30 minutes, and they obtained the product in high yield. So, some closing remarks for this include that Lewis acids and Bronsted acids can be used to promote the Diels-Alder reaction. When you use different catalysts, which could be Bronsted acids or Lewis acids, you're going to have conditions which favor certain isomers, and this also may enhance your yield. But it's not like it's just going to affect the outcome you want. It's going to change all the chemistry, and so these usually need to be screened one at a time. If you employ a chiral catalyst, you might get enantioselective chemistry, although oftentimes you still get small amounts of other enantiomers, and this is just an issue that chemists deal with in general. Usually when you have a catalyst that's enantioselective, you do still get some amounts of the other enantiomer, and if you can't have that, you have to get rid of it somehow. And because enantiomers behave identically chemically with achiral substrates, it can be challenging to remove them on occasion. As a whole, I would say that paracyclic reactions such as the Diels-Alder could be used more frequently than they currently are in synthetic chemistry. I think that they're extremely powerful, and I hope the one thing you take away from this lecture is that if you see a six-membered ring, you should think, this could come from a Diels-Alder reaction. So thanks for listening to this lecture. If you want to see me do more in the future, make sure you leave a comment down below. Although, as I said earlier, I'm not planning on making any more lecture videos for a while. And Maurice, I hope you have a very Merry Christmas. And to the rest of you viewers, I hope you have a very Merry Christmas as well. Thanks for watching, and I hope you have a great day.